I Dr. Palash, all ready?
Yes, sir. All ready.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this afternoon episode of Pursue 5S. And this is General Pathology. And today we are dealing with Neoplasia Session 2. And to talk on that, we have Dr. Major Palash Kumar Mandal, who is an MD and an Associate Professor in Pathology at Sagar Datta Medical College, Kolkata, a very famous person in Calcutta. He is also the lab director of the famous Deason Hospital and Heart Institute, Kolkata. Before I ask Major Mandal to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Major Mandal, sir, please share your screen and let's start.
Thank you so much, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. Today we will discuss
Yeah, we can see your screen, right?
Good afternoon, everybody. We will be continuing our topic, Neoplasia. Today is the second topic, second lecture on neoplasia, and we will begin with where we left last day, that is with the metastatic part. The tumor, the most important characteristic which determines a malignant tumor is metastasis, and metastasis is the actual end point of a tumor which leads to the death of the host. So we start with that thing only. Take some time to begin this.
No problem.
So, this we have discussed what are the various pathways of spread of a malignant tumor, and to recapitulate, dissemination of a malignant tumor can occur through these pathways: direct seeding of the body cavities or surfaces, for example spread via CSF, ependymoma and meningioma, there is a spelling mistake, meningioma, which can spread through CSF, through the epithelium along the body line surfaces like the surfaces of the tubes, and natural surfaces like ureter, bronchus, the tumor may spread along the surfaces, or it may directly land up in the body cavities like the peritoneal cavity, the pleural cavity, and so on. Okay, so that is the direct seeding, and also these cavities may be seeded by the implantation through direct spread from a tumor or through an iatrogenic spread. That iatrogenic word means the spread by outside person. So most likely the spread indicates, the iatrogenic spread indicates either some manipulation by the doctor or nursing staff or so on. So basically this is the direct seeding of the body cavities. Okay, so we have seen lymphatic spread, most important for carcinomas, hematogenous spread, most important for sarcomas. So these are the various methods or the various pathways through which a malignant tumor can spread. And though no tissue as such is spared of metastasis, but unfavorable sites means the sites where metastasis occurs rarely, the sites are heart, the skeletal muscle, and the spleen. Okay. So this is the way how a metastasis happens. You have to know this thing, because if you don't understand how a tumor metastasizes, the whole story will be incomplete. Okay, So just knowing the pathways is not sufficient. You will have to, especially the MD students, they will have to know the detailed process of invasion and metastasis. Okay. So now we have understood that a tumor goes from one site, that is the site of origin, to a distant site, that is the metastatic site. Now how it goes? It may go through blood vessel, it may go through lymphatic, but what is the basic mechanism that a tumor embolus, the tumor cells, how do they traverse the such a long distance from, suppose it, going from a foot, a melanoma of a foot, going to the inguinal lymph node, going to the lungs. So how does this tumor spread? So that is the basis we will learn today. Now this is called the metastatic cascade, taken from Robbins, a very familiar picture. So it looks like a river. Okay, so this image, it looks like a river. So if you have to write the answer, please draw this image. Please draw this image. I request all my students, whenever you are writing answer in pathology, always try to draw some diagrams, and not only it will give more weightage to your answer, it will also make you understand it in a better way. Okay, so there are two basic phases of metastatic cascade. It is called a cascade. And what are they? First is the invasion of the extracellular matrix. Extracellular matrix is basically whatever is outside the cell, whatever is outside the parenchyma. Suppose we are having a tumor in the foot, so that is a squamous, suppose it is a squamous cell carcinoma, okay, or a melanoma, which is confined to the epithelium. Now extracellular matrix means once it goes outside the epithelium into the underlying stroma, the connective tissue, that is called ECM. We have discussed ECM, the components of ECM, everything has been discussed, so we did not go back word by word into that. So basically invasion of the extracellular matrix, and second is the vascular dissemination. So this vascular may indicate not only blood vessel, it may indicate a lymphatic vessel also. And since this is a classical example, there are other mechanisms of metastasis as well, as I told you, through the fallopian tube, through the direct seeding and all. So those have not been described here, but we are just describing the classical method or a classic example how a tumor metastasizes from one site to the other. Okay, so basically these are the following steps. It is given in a single image, and what are they? Clonal expansion of the growth, diversification, and angiogenesis. These factors are most important for a tumor growth. First, the tumor has to grow. Say 20 cell tumor or 50 cell tumor or 100 cell tumor just cannot metastasize like that. The tumor volume should be more. The tumor should become eligible for metastasis. That means the tumor should mature. Understand? A tumor should mature. A tumor, just a young tumor, let us say a 20 days old tumor or a 30 days old tumor, may not metastasize. Suppose a tumor reaches 45 days, 2 months, 3 months, then the propensity to metastasize develops. Okay, and it varies from tumor to tumor. I am just giving an odd example, so it may not always follow like this, but in most cases a tumor must develop the capacity to metastasize. So that is why it is written clonal expansion. The clone should expand, the tumor clone should expand, there should be growth of the clone. There should be diversification, means the tumor should acquire certain characteristics which will lead it to go from one place to the other. And angiogenesis, you see, what is angiogenesis? The supply of blood to the tumor site. Okay, so you see, this is a blood vessel. From here another vessel has originated and gone to supply this area, and this area here is also leading to the supply of nutrients to that area. That is why that area, that is the tumor area, is proliferating, because if you cut down the blood supply, the tumor cells will die. So angiogenesis is very, very important for tumor growth. Okay. So, out of this primary tumor, a metastatic subclone develops. So, it has been seen. You see, whenever there is a war, not all people are sent to the forefront. And even then, even if the fighting soldiers are there, out of them, some are selected to perform certain operations. Like, why do I give all these examples? As I was in the army, I think of that line only. So, in the Bangladesh war, at one point of time, the opponent army had blocked, and they had broken and damaged the bridges so that the Indian army cannot penetrate or take their tanks through the bridges and reach the other side of Bangladesh. Okay, so then what happened? So Indian army at that point of time, which was led by Field Marshal Manekshaw, so General Manekshaw thought that why can't we drop some soldiers through parachute to the other side without even crossing that area. So they collected a very good band of soldiers known as para commandos. Those para commandos were airlifted and dropped into the territory of the army behind the barricade, where the actual barricade of this enemy soldiers was there, where the bridges had been broken so that our army cannot progress. So, but these people, they went there and landed there through parachutes, and they neutralized some of the enemies, and eventually they built up some bridges. Army engineers are very fast in bridging, making bridges. Let me tell you, it doesn't take months, it takes just days, or at times even hours. They can put in so fast such a bridge. That bridge may not be a permanent bridge, these are temporary bridges, but the heavy vehicles can also move through that. So army has a specialized engineer corps. Okay, like medical corps, engineer corps is also there. So anyway, just to make the thing interesting, so what happens is that a metastatic subclone develops. So those cells which are able to metastasize, not all the primary tumor cells will be able to metastasize, remember that. So a special subclone which can metastasize, which can penetrate, which can go beyond the certain area of the primary tumor, those are known as the metastatic subclone. Am I clear? Please remember this thing. Why I am making you understand? Because all these things you cannot see under the microscope. Okay, metastasis is one process which is a dynamic process. You cannot see it under the microscope. You cannot see it in the under the slides. I am telling the postgraduates, because undergraduates are not exposed to slide seeing so much, but postgraduates who do keep on seeing slides. But this part of metastasis cannot be visualized. It is a dynamic process. Okay. You can see a metastasis which has already happened in a lymph node or in a different site, but you cannot see the actual process, how it is happening. Okay, so please try to understand the basis. And these have been all researched and found out. Nothing is mine, and it has been taken up from the books. So, but please try to understand this. Okay, now then what happens after the development of the metastatic clone? They have to breach this basement membrane. There is a basement membrane which is guarding the tumor cells from the matrix. Okay, now this basement membrane has to be broken apart so that these cells can penetrate. Okay, penetrate and adhesion to an invasion of the basement membrane. Okay, so now what they are doing, they are going to the basement membrane. This is the basement membrane. There are two basement membranes actually. One is the basement membrane of the tumor or the parenchyma, where it has to invade first, reach the extracellular matrix, and then come to another basement membrane, which is the basement membrane of the blood vessel. Okay, or that adventitia. Okay, so adventitia of the blood vessel and the basement membrane of the parenchyma. So this has to be broken. Okay, and even the ECM has another basement membrane on the other side, so that is adhered to the adventitia. So this is again another basement membrane. Am I clear? So one basement membrane, another basement membrane, beneath which the adventitial layer of the blood vessel. Fine. So passes through the invasion of the basement membrane. Here it is invading, going through the extracellular matrix, and is invading here through the adventitia, media, and finally the intima, and interacting with the host lymphoid cells. So it finds out the host lymphocytes, which are traversing through the blood vessel, which are already traversing through the blood in the blood vessel. They try to find out, that is the carrier. Okay, so if a person has to go to a place, suppose a person wants to go from South Calcutta to North Calcutta, that person has to take some vehicle. It may be a train, it may be a bus, it may be a taxi, whichever mode of conveyance he or she wants to take, that is up to him. But some conveyance is necessary, or otherwise it will take a long time to reach. Okay, so here also this clever metastatic clones, they try to find out who the conveyance will be. So they find lymphocytes, which are quite attractive conveyance. So this is lymphocyte is the taxi out here. Okay, so interaction with the host lymphoid cell and leads to the formation of tumor embolus. So they become a group. Okay, because that is the principle: united we stand, divided we fall. Understand? So they have to form a group, because if they don't form a group, individual tumor cells floating around will be shot dead by the tumor, the T lymphocytes, and there are some the cytokines, the macrophages. Individual cells may be killed very fast, but if there is a tumor embolus, the tumor cells are together, it is difficult to kill all of them together at a time. Okay, so now the adhesion has, now this tumor embolus, they will go and they will find out a suitable site for metastasis. Now this particular thing, this depends on the liberation of certain signals, certain chemokines, and the chemokines indicate where the tumor will metastasize. Okay, they have some preferences, the preferences being the supply of the vascular supply of the particular area. Because a tumor, suppose a breast cancer, which is traversing through the lymphatic vessel, naturally it will go to the axillary lymph node first. It will not go to the liver first, isn't it? So the proximity to the primary tumor, the vascular or lymphatic supply to the area, that will indicate where it will land. And also certain chemokines are there, which are liberated, and that leads to the attraction of the tumor embolus, and eventually they find a site which is a little weak. A weak site they find out, so that they can penetrate the endothelial line, the medial line, the adventitial line, and eventually land up in the extracellular matrix and home on to the particular site. Okay, so this is in a nutshell, how it happens. So if you understand this, your understanding of the metastasis is over. But we will discuss each step in a bit details, that is most important for the MD students. Okay, even for the undergraduates, a part of it may be asked how it is happening, so you may need to explain. But for postgraduates, this is very important. You need have to understand each step and remember certain molecules, certain chemokines which are associated with each sub step. So this we have already discussed. The invasion of the extracellular matrix. After the breaching of the basement membrane, how does this invasion actually happen? You see, they are saying it is an active process. Active process. Why it is an active process? The tumor cell has to first dissociate, the loosening up of tumor cell. Tumor cells are also tightly adhered to each other. So the metastatic clone which has developed, they need to be released from the primary tumor group. Okay, primary tumor group. So that is called loosening up. Okay, so the tumor cells have to loosen up. Then there is the loosening up of intracellular junctions. Okay, the there is both this thing happen. There is a loosening up of the tumor-tumor cell interaction and there is a loosening up of the intracellular junction, because both are needed for the active process of a cell going from one side to the other. Because if the intracellular normal epithelial bridges are very tight, the tightly adherent bridges will not lead to entry of anything. But tumor has the capacity to invade, and that is through the loosening of the intracellular junction by some cytokines, and these are the ones which are important. Okay. So what is there? They are saying the loosening of intercellular junctions. This one was tight and they bound by cadherins. E-cadherin is one of them which binds the laminin, the collagen of the epithelial cells. Okay, the epithelial basement membrane cells. So now this becomes loose. Okay, the wide gap is there. And there is degradation of the ECM. Degradation, because by degradation means the tight junctions are gradually degraded, and that leads to the weakening of the bond between the two cells. Okay, and attachment to novel ECM components. The cells, what do? They try to find out which are the most important cells, which are the most important cells which will help them to for their entry. Okay, which will help them for their entry. And finally, there is the attachment of the novel components and migration of the tumor cells. Fine. Attachment and finally migration of the tumor cells. Am I clear? So what it means is that here there is this junction is there, the junction is loosened up, it is a tumor, it may be, let me tell you, this particular picture is actually depicting not the epithelial junction, this particular thing is showing just the tumor cell adhesion. Okay, I correct myself. So these cells are actually not the epithelial cells. This is the basement membrane and these are the tumor cells. Okay, the tumor cells were adhered to each other by cadherins, and once the metastatic clone develops, these tumor cells have to traverse the basement membrane and go to the ECM. Okay, so they find how to do that is that first they have to loosen up, then they lead this the extracellular matrix has to be dissolved, ECM has to be dissolved or degraded, so that their passage becomes easier. They try to attach themselves to the ECM components may be the type 4 collagens, there are plasminogen activators, this is the collagenase activators that lead to the degradation of the membrane. Okay, and they try to find out attachments are necessary, because attachments are like bridges or like ropes. So person who cannot go through the, suppose a thief wants to go to the top floor of a house, so he has to find out some ways. So he cannot take the normal stairs, so he can find out some areas like walls, the parapets or something like that, or he can use some things like ropes. Okay, so these attachments to the extracellular components act as ropes. Okay, and ultimately the tumor cell with the attachments developed goes to the ECM. Am I clear? So why I took time to make you understand, this is a very small picture, but the most important thing is that you have to understand the tumor cell cannot go on its own normally. It has to find, first loosen up, then find some attachments, then only it can go. So this we have told you, the eke adherins are there which lead to the cellular interactions. So now down regulation of this eke adherin family, that is very important in some of the carcinomas like adenocarcinoma of the colon, carcinoma of the breast, where this eke adherin which tightly binds one cell to the other is down regulated, and this is one of the factors which will lead to metastasis, because we are talking of metastasis, tumor growth and then the metastatic clone, then the movement. Okay, metastasis is nothing but a movement of a tumor from one place to the other. Okay, now degradation, what, how does it happen? Through the proteolytic enzymes. Okay, and one of the most important proteolytic enzymes is the MMPs, the group, that is the group matrix metalloproteinases, and also plasminogen activators, etc. What do? They actually act on the certain components of the basement membrane, certain components of the ECM, and degrade them. Why degradation is necessary? Because if the pathway is not cleared, how can the tumor move? Isn't it? You have to clear the pathway. There are obstacles. These basement membrane, the extracellular matrix, all are obstacles for the tumor. So they have to breach that obstacle, clear the pathway, then only the tumor will move through the cleared path. Understand? So these metalloproteinases, they are nothing but enzymes. So these enzymes, the plasminogen activators, these enzymes, they clear up the pathway and they lead to the degradation of the collagens and other components so that the tumor can progress. And basically everything is the same. The tumor cells will degrade, the tumor cells will dissociate, the area will degrade, and the tumor cell will move forward. That is given in this whole slide. Now the movement, as you know, is known as locomotion. Movement is locomotion, and this is the final step of invasion. Propelling of the tumor cells through the degraded basement and the zones of matrix proteolysis. Zones of matrix proteolysis means that pathway has been already cleared. The degraded basement membrane, the basement membranes have been degraded. The door has been opened up. The pathway has been made. The road has been laid down. Okay. Now the tumor cell has only to just walk that road and reach the destination. Okay. So that is it. But it is not so simple. It is still a complex multi-step process that involves many families of receptors, signal proteins. Signal proteins that act on the cytoskeletal proteins. Okay, there are signal proteins which act on the cytoskeletal proteins. Understand? And the cells attach to the matrix at the leading edge, detach from the matrix at the trailing edge. Okay, so what is the leading edge? So this is the leading edge. Okay, first attachment, then this becomes the trailing edge. Means the they have to detachment. First attachment, detachment. Attachment, detachment. So leading edge, attachment, trailing edge, detachment. Okay. And then the cytoskeleton, which is the actin cytoskeleton, which is necessary for the locomotion, the cellular movement, the cellular structure is maintained by these cytoskeleton proteins. We have already discussed. And through their contraction and relaxation, the cell moves forward like this. Okay. And there are some cytokines also, like autocrine motility factors. These regulate the movement to a particular location. The tumor cell, where it will home on, that is very important. If it goes and hits a wall, then no purpose is solved. It has to find area where the door is slightly open. then it will make the door wide open and enter. If the door is totally closed, bolted from inside, then it cannot enter. Okay. So that is why these factors, they give signals. Okay. Vascular dissemination. Once the basement membrane has been breached, the extracellular matrix has been opened up, now the cells go to the vessel. Because vessel is the actual vehicle. Understand? Because you see, in certain areas, like in the Venice and all, the primary mode of transport is through the river, river transport. So in the river, there are boats. So that is the way how the people go from one place to the other, even today. Okay. We see inside that circulation, what do the tumor cells do? They aggregate in clumps, that I told you, united we stand, and they form. These aggregates are also made stronger by the host tissues like platelets. Okay, the platelets also help in adhering the tumor cells. Okay, together they act as some gums or glue. Okay, and lead to enhanced tumor cell survival. Tumor cells become more strong to survive because they are coming in a different environment, the hostile environment, because from everywhere there are bullets coming. Okay. So to protect themselves, they form a round ball. Okay. That is called tumor ball. And the tumor cells may also bind and activate certain coagulation factors also. The coagulation factors are in blood. They also bind to some lymphocytes. So, lymphocytes, platelets, coagulation factors together help to give a shield to the tumor ball. Okay. The shield to the tumor ball, and with the flow of the blood or flow of the lymph, the tumor cells gradually move forward like the other cellular components of the blood. Now, arrest and extravasation. Now, what happens is that it cannot move on indefinitely. It has to go and home on to a particular place. The target, destination, everything is fixed. Almost. We don't know at this stage how it is fixed from beforehand, but it is almost certain that that particular tumor will reach this particular area. This breast tumor will reach this axillary lymph node. Okay. This is called arrest and extravasation of the tumor emboli at a distant site. Arrest means the growth will and the movement will be arrested. We will stop. Okay. Then the tumor cell, what it has to do? It has to come out of the vessel and go on to the local area. Understand? And that is helped by addition molecules like integrins, laminin receptors, and again the basement membrane of that particular area needs to be broken. The endothelial cell, that is the intimal lining, the medial lining, the adventitia lining, everything has to be broken by the proteolytic enzymes. The rent has to be opened up so that this tumor cell can traverse through that. They have an amoeboid movement. Through this amoeboid movement, they can traverse the area of travel through the zone of the blood vessels and extracellular matrix and go on to a particular site. Okay. So these adhesion molecules and proteolytic enzymes, they lead to the homing in of the particular tumor in a particular selective area. Now at the new site also the tumor cells will proliferate, develop vascular supply, that is called angiogenesis. The angiogenesis leads to the growth of new blood vessels, which are also supported by various factors like this vascular endothelial growth factors, fibroblast growth factors, and so many factors are responsible for the local angiogenesis. And the tumor cells, once they reach, they get good blood supply, that is their food. Once they have good food, they become strong. They become strong to do what? Do damage only. Not a good thing. They will only become strong and they will lead to the death of the person. Understand? So if you let your enemy be strong, so you will definitely are inviting for trouble for yourself. That is quite obvious. So now, what are the sites of secondary deposit? First, the capillary bed should be available to the tumor, but some tumors like prostate cancer, they spread to the bone. They have preferential sites. I told you, sites are predetermined. So prostate will spread to the bone, lung cancer will go to the adrenal, the brain. The adrenals are quite far away from lung, but still it will go to that place because of some certain addition molecules, some chemokines which are attracting this tumor cell. So instead of going to the nearest location, it traverses a long path and still homes onto a particular location of choice. Okay. So there are many molecular factors which are there. So microRNAs are there, and some suppress tumor metastasis while some promote tumor metastasis. So the interaction between the metastatic suppressors and metastatic promoters, that will determine how much a tumor will metastasize. Okay. There are some metastatic oncogenes like SLEN, TWIST and so on. I mean, there are many in fact now. So, but eventually there are the suppressors and promoters everywhere. This balance is always there. So balance, if it tilts to one side, it indicate which way the thing will happen. Okay. So this is again a picture from Robbins, that metastatic variants. So some tumors, they develop this metastatic variant very fast. So that is called metastatic signature. So those tumors will metastasize quite fast. And some tumors, they do not develop metastatic signature initially, but the stroma, the environment, the microenvironment leads to the generation of metastatic variants, and then they try to metastasize. Initially, they were not accustomed, or they were not so expert in metastasis, but the tumor environment, the chemokines and certain cytokines, growth promoting factors, they led to the development of metastatic variants. Okay. Coming to the next phase of our topic today, is that is epidemiological factors. So now you see, once we are coming, we will gradually move on to the molecular basis of cancer. Okay. So because neoplasia is such a big chapter, I have broken my whole topic into multiple lectures, so that it is for easier for you to understand and also remember. And I always tell my students, please make notes according to your own understanding. Okay. So that when you write up in your exam, when you write in your exam, when you speak in your Viva exam, so you should be very clear of what you are saying. Okay. So don't beat about the bush. You try to develop a clear understanding of the topic, because this topic, as I tell you, is not a very easy topic. Okay. Multiple things are there. You need to have a very clear cut idea of what is happening. Okay. Though many things are still unknown, many things are still unknown in malignancy. Okay. Now, so the age, the sex, that is the gender, the race, the familial and genetic factors, everything has some role to play in the development of malignancy. Okay. Environmental cultural factors like the smoking, chewing tobacco, alcoholism, and environmental factors like poverty. Okay. Social factors like poverty and unhygienic conditions, they lead to development of carcinoma cervix, penile cancer. Okay. And diet, definitely diet is very, very important, because but certain diets, they lead to promotion of a particular type of malignancy, especially that the gastric cancer, the colonic cancer, very specifically they have dietary associations. Okay. And there are some pre-neoplastic conditions, means if you see that disease which has happened, then it is bound to develop into a malignancy. So the best. Why do we need to identify these conditions? Because if we can terminate the disease, if we can take out the disease at that particular stage, the chances of developing into a full-blown malignancy becomes smaller. Okay, so there is something known as CIN or cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, pertinent for cervical cancers. So if you can take out the CIN completely, there is no chance of development of a squamous cell carcinoma of the cervix. Okay, so you have to understand that there are some benign tumors also. One of them is familial adenomatous polyposis, FAP. So genetic disorder, but initially the tumors are benign. But what happens over a period of time, almost all the tumors, they turn malignant. There are hundreds of tumors in the colon. All the tumors, they are initially benign, but all the tumors become malignant if you leave them. So that is the thing. So even in bone directly Hansen's disease, so this disease of the nerves, so the multiple neurofibromas gradually develop into malignant lesions. Okay. And also there are certain disorders like cirrhosis of liver, Margillin's ulcer happens with burns, chronic bronchitis, all may lead to development of malignancy. Okay. So these epidemiological factors, environmental factors, you have to be very, very careful. Why we are stressing that you don't do this, why do you don't that? Because it has been statistically seen the association of these various factors with malignancy. Okay. So that is why the understanding is very important. Now, as you know that the cancer has its basis in the genes. So there has to be some genetic alteration for a cancer to develop. By now, I think you have had you have understood this basic point. So, is it a genetic disease or it is a familial disease? There is a difference. Genetic disease means a person having a genetic mutation in his lifetime develops a malignancy. So that is called a genetic disease. Okay, because that is causing genetic alteration. But now the genetic disease becomes familial when it is goes from one generation to the another generation. Okay, so a lady who is having a breast cancer or an ovarian cancer will give that offspring of that lady, that is the daughter of that lady, will have a higher chance of developing a breast or ovarian cancer. Okay. So, because there are certain genes which have been found, which are transmitted, and those genes are called familial cancer genes. Okay. So, this is important, and we have a list of disease, the inherited cancer syndromes, which are due to some mutations in these genes, like the retinoblastoma genes mutation leads to retinoblastoma, P53 gene mutation leads to Leaf-Romani syndrome, where multiple tumors develop. Actually, P53 is called the guardian of the genome. So if that guardian becomes disturbed, so many tumors can develop simultaneously, called Leaf-Romani syndrome. So you have the whole list with you. So this is taken from Robbins again. So this I am not going to read one by one, but just to give an example, these are the autosomal inherited cancer, autosomal dominant inherited cancer syndromes, because this means a person who is developing a retinoblastoma, if that person marries and has children, those children will be having high chance of developing retinoblastoma. Okay, so it is an autosomal dominant cancer syndrome. And all this, not only one, this BRCA1, BRCA2, which I was talking about, breast and ovarian tumors, similarly, there are all these diseases which are mentioned here. Okay, autosomal recessive cancer syndromes. Now, these are autosomal recessive, like xeroderma pigmentosum, ataxia telangiectasia, Bloom syndrome, Fanconi's anemia. So these are inherited autosomal recessive syndromes, autosomal recessive, not sex chromosomal, autosomal recessive syndrome of DNA repair. So DNA repair, if it is defective, if it is but it is an autosomal recessive, because only if the person is autosomal recessive, then only the person will develop this thing, because the both the genes have to be defective in an autosomal recessive disorder, whereas only single defective gene in autosomal dominant disorder can lead to tumor formation. That is the we will discuss the genetics in next the once we finish neoplasia. Okay, and familiar cancers, what are they? They're the clustering of cases, and the role of inherited predisposition is of course not very clear. Now, who will develop breast cancer from a mother, which daughter will develop, those intricate details are still not very clear, because if you have BRCA1 mutation, you may or may not develop breast cancer. So, you know, very famous film personality Angelina Jolie, she removed both her breasts because she had a high chance of developing breast cancer. But you see, it's still unpredictable. It's not that the 100% chance are there. So you cannot predict. Malignancy is such an unpredictable disease. That's why it is still remains an enigma to the oncologist. Okay. Malignancy can also happen with some inflammatory diseases. Asbestosis. These are the environmental diseases. Asbestosis, silicosis, even bronchitis, okay, inflammatory bowel disease, gingivitis, pancreatitis, so many diseases can lead to malignancy. So many just inflammatory diseases can lead to malignancy, okay. And diseases associated with infectious agents. Liver flukes leading to cholangiocarcinoma. Bacteria leading to gallbladder carcinoma. Helicobacter pylori, again a bacteria, leading to gastric adenocarcinoma, gastric lymphomas. Hepatitis B and C virus leading to hepatocellular carcinomas and so on. EB virus leads to so many malignancies, starting from nasopharyngeal carcinoma to Hodgkin's lymphoma. So all these are associated with some viral infection. And one of the most very strong association we have found with cervical cancer is the human papilloma virus. Okay, HPV 16 and 18 strains, which are strongly associated with cervical cancer. Okay, this example I am not saying here, but this cervical cancer is strongly associated with HPV, and that has led to the vaccination program also. Though it is not very successful, I must say, but still vaccines are available. Excuse me. Okay. In spite of everything, if one tries to lead a very non-indulgent life, doesn't expose himself or herself to the vices, the alcohol, the smoking, takes as pure food as possible, the organic food, the everything is there, but in spite of that, the cancer cannot, it is not certain that cancer will not touch you. And this is the one of the image in this pictures from this Munna Bhai MBBS picture, and that is the images have been taken from that movie. This gentleman, Jimmy Shergill, develops a certain type of very rare type of a malignancy, not rare, a type of malignancy, and he asks Sanjay Dutt, why did I develop? I led a very pious life. I did not indulge in any activity like alcoholism, smoking, etc., etc. But why I developed this malignancy? So this is still an enigma. In spite of everything, you can try anything, but if malignancy has to target you, you will become a target. Very sad thing, but it is true. Okay, and you see, so many oncologists who have treated so many, who have cured so many malignant, so many patients of this cancers, they themselves have died of malignancies. Okay, so the oncologists themselves could not cure them because it is such a difficult disease. I was associated with Thakur Pukur Cancer Hospital, known as Saroj Gupta Cancer Institute and Cancer Center and Research Institute. So the founder director of that institute, Padma Sri Saroj Gupta sir, he died of lung cancer. Dr. Ashish Mukherjee, very famous oncologist who developed this Netaji Subhas Cancer, he also died of carcinoma of gallbladder. So, and even now there are oncologists who are very famous oncologists in Calcutta. They are suffering from malignancies. I don't want to name them. This is not needed, but very famous oncologists who are there in Calcutta, at least two of them I know are suffering from malignancies. Okay, so this cancer is still an enigma, still very difficult to know why it is happening and to whom it is happening. Okay, so we have almost come to the end of our topic, and I will just touch upon the molecular basis of cancer in two slides only, and we will discuss the molecular basis in details in our next lecture. So the fundamental principles of molecular basis is that there is a non-lethal genetic damage. Non-lethal, because had it been a lethal damage, then the cell would have died. But it is a non-lethal genetic damage due to the action of some environmental agents like chemicals, radiations, viruses, or so many things, then followed by a clonal expansion of that particular genetically damaged cell, which becomes a malignant cell. Okay, and there is a multi-step process where multiple mutations, not one genetic mutation, not one genetic damage, but there are multiple genetic damages which happen, and eventually a malignancy, a full-blown malignancy or a malignant clone develops. Okay, it's not so easy because body has checks and bounds for everything. Body tries to prevent the occurrence of malignancy. Body tries to kill the damaged cell or a genetically damaged cell by the process of apoptosis. But when it has to develop, it will try to evade all those things and still go on to become malignant. So the four principal targets, are the four classes of normal regulatory genes. These are the normal regulatory growth cycles that where the growth, this all the regulatory genes of the growth cycle, the four targets, if you can damage these four targets, your thing is achieved. So again, to give an example of the war, if you can kill the person or the soldiers who are at the front line, then you can progress. If you can kill the soldiers who are guarding a fort, you can enter the fort. It is something like that. So there are these four classes of normal regulatory genes. If they can be mutated, if they can be damaged, then the tumor will occur and it will start growing. Okay. What are these four? Proto-oncogenes, tumor suppressor genes, the genes regulating apoptosis, and the genes which are involved in DNA repair. And what are the seven cellular changes that determine malignancy? What is the self-sufficiency, that is the capacity to proliferate without external stimuli. Insensitivity to growth inhibitor signals. The growth inhibitor signal, there are signaling molecules which will inhibit the tumor growth, but in spite of that, they will evade apoptosis. Limitless replicative potential, they will limit, they will go on proliferating without any stoppage and barrier. Sustained angiogenesis. Angiogenesis is the food for them. The food is brought through angiogenesis, that is the all the nutrients are brought through blood vessels, and the ability to invade and metastasize, the development of the metastatic clone, that is the most important thing, because if it were localized, if it were not ability to metastasize, the tumor would have not caused so much of damage. Okay, even benign tumors, they grow, even benign tumors compress the local area, but since they do not metastasize, they do not kill the person so fast. Only metastatic tumor kills, because you cannot understand where all it has gone. You can take out the primary tumor, But if it has spread to 50 different places, it is not possible to take out all the different metastatic areas. Okay. And the defects in DNA repair, because even if the DNA, the damage has happened, if the DNA repair genes were active, they would have either repaired the DNA damage or they would have forced the cell to go into apoptosis. But the defects in DNA repair leads to this genomic instability and the progression of the mutation. Okay, and progression of the mutation and leading to the proliferation of the mutant clone, that is the tumor clone. And this is the thing I will discuss in my next class. So, thank you so much. I think I have come to the end of the topic today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mandal. Excellent presentation with very nice anecdotes from Munna Bhai. Excellently presented, and especially the way you explained the army not being able to cross the bridge, you using paratroopers to explain how the metastatic lesion, you know, travels from one point to the other. Excellently done. You're an expert in general pathology and neoplasia, let me tell you. Right? So we'll be eagerly waiting for the next topic, that is neoplasia session 3.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much. Take care. God bless you. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.